morning, buenos dias, welcome. Today is the feast, a special feast. It's a feast of the dedication of the Lateran Basilica in Rome. It's one of the major churches in Rome, so it's a special feast day. We're going to have a very, very special guest say the Mass today. Now, Father Dominic is on retreat, and so today we have Bishop Bartosik. So he's actually our auxiliary bishop for our parish, and very special guest here today for Mass. Just a real quick reminder, when we are doing the readings, because today we actually, because it's a feast day, we will have a first reading and a second reading. So the first reading and the second reading, when the readers, when the lectors say at the end, they say the word of the Lord, what do we all say? I heard some nice people, okay, one more time. The word of the Lord, we say? That's right, and then the responsorial psalm. So Nate, where's Nathan? Nathan, where are you? There he is. Nathan's going to be reading the responsorial psalm today. And the responsorial psalm is a little bit longer today, so I'm going to say it real quick so that you guys can say it loudly and answer Nathan. It goes, the waters of the river gladden the city of God. That's a big mouthful, and we're not even done yet. So we can say, the waters of the river gladden the city of God. Go ahead, try that one. The waters of the river gladden the city of God. And then we continue and say, the holy dwelling of the Most High. The holy dwelling of the Most High. It's a long responsorial psalm, so try your best with that one. And then there will be a second reading, and then when the gospel is said, we don't say the word of the Lord, thanks be to God. At the beginning, it's a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John today, and we say, glory to you, O Lord. And we make a cross on our forehead, our mouth, and our heart to, again, think about, ask God to help us think about the word we're about to hear, to speak it to others, and to keep it close to our hearts. And at the end, Bishop Bartosik will say the gospel of the Lord. And we don't say thanks be to God. The gospel of the Lord, we say praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So let's practice that. The gospel of the Lord, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Nice and loud. Because I know Father Dominic, Ms. Lasica, so many of the parishioners have been so impressed with the way that you guys have really been more vocal this year in responding to the prayers. It's been awesome to see. You guys are doing an amazing job, and it takes time to learn all these things, but you guys are doing an awesome job. So well done, and let's impress the bishop.
Saints in heaven. Let us take a moment to to think about where we have to adjust our lives and change them so that that can happen. Let us call to mind our sins and ask of the Lord His mercy. You came to heal the sick. Lord, have mercy. You came to forgive sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, where you intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. The angel brought me back to the entrance of the temple, and I saw water flowing out from beneath the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the facade of the temple was towards the east. The water flowed down from the southern side of the temple, south of the altar. He led me outside by the north gate and around the outer gate facing the east, where I saw water trickling from the southern side. He said to me, "This water flows into the eastern district down upon the Arabah and empties into the sea, the salt waters, which makes it fresh. Wherever the river flows, every sort of living creature that can multiply shall live, and there shall be an abundant fish. For wherever this water comes, the sea shall be made fresh. Along both banks of the river, fruit trees of every kind shall grow. Their leaves shall not fade, nor their fruit fail. Every month they shall bear fresh fruit, for they shall be watered by the flow from the sanctuary. Their fruit shall serve for food, and their leaves for medication. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our response will be, the waters of the river gladden the city of God. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in distress. Therefore we fear not, though the earth be shaken, and the mountains plunge into the depths of the sea. The waters of the river gladden the city of God, the holy dwelling of the Most High. There is a stream whose runlets gladden the city of God, the holy dwelling of the Most High. God in its midst, it shall not be disturbed. God will help it at the break of dawn. The waters of the river gladden the city of God, the holy dwelling of the Most High. The Lord of hosts is with us. Our stronghold is God of Jacob. Come, behold the deeds of the Lord, and astounding things he has wrought on this earth. The waters of the river gladden the city of God, the holy dwelling of the Most High.
Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, you are God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a wise master builder, I laid a foundation, and another is building upon it. But each one must be careful how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than the one that is there, namely, Jesus Christ. Do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, for the temple of God, which is you, is holy. The word of the Lord.
Since the Passover of the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as the money changers seated there. He made a whip out of cords and drove them all out of the temple area with the sheep and oxen and spilled the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables and said to those who sold doves, Take these out of here and stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. Therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they came to believe the scripture and the words Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord. Zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews were a little bit different from us in that they only had one temple, one church, one building. In the whole country, there's only one, and it was in Jerusalem. And maybe because it was so holy for them, it was destroyed 3 times in the history of Israel by their enemies. It was destroyed about 600 years before Jesus. It was rebuilt. It was messed with a little bit later and then destroyed about 60 years after Jesus. Still hasn't been rebuilt. So it was really important for them. Once a year you had to go to the temple and you had to offer sacrifice. Doves, an ox, a sheep, a barrel full of whatever you raised on your farm. You had to sacrifice that. That was their idea of showing God that they cared about him. And the first time the temple was destroyed, we've been reading about this on Sunday in the second reading for the last number of weeks. The first time the temple was destroyed, 500 and some years before Jesus, the people were all carried off into captivity, and they thought, now what do we do? We don't have a temple. The priests are all dead. We can't offer sacrifice on the altar because we've been carried off into a foreign land. What are we going to do? How are we going to put ourselves right with God? And the prophets said, well, you can offer yourself. You can make a gift of yourself to God. Give your heart to God. Not a calf, not a dove, not a sheep. Give God yourself, and that'll be enough without the temple. And that's what the Lord is saying in today's gospel. So the new temple that was rebuilt, that took 46 years to build, he's predicting that it'll be destroyed too. And what do we have now, right? That's the question underneath the Lord's question. What we have now is Jesus himself. We have the body of Jesus. That's where we go to get right with God. That's the idea. Zeal for your house will consume me. And the thing is, where does God live? What is God's house? It's Jesus. It's Jesus' body. That's where God lives. If you want to know God, if you want to come to know God, you come to Jesus. Zeal for your house, zeal for Jesus, will consume me. We celebrate today the dedication of a church building in Rome that is really the most important church in the world. Even more important than the historic sites in Jerusalem where Jesus rose from the dead and was buried. It's a beautiful church there. But the Lateran Basilica is the Pope's church. It's the church where he reigns as Bishop of Rome. It's not the Vatican. The Vatican is more beautiful and bigger and certainly more well known. But for us, that's not as important as the Lateran Basilica, which is the cathedral of the city of Rome. Our cathedral is downtown on State and Chicago. It's called the Cathedral of the Holy Name. That's where our bishop, Cardinal Supich, governs from that church. But for us, for the whole church and throughout the whole world, the Pope governs the church from the cathedra, from the seat, from the throne in the Basilica of St. John Lateran. And it's from there that he calls us, every one of us, all throughout the world, to make a gift of your life. I'm thinking about Father Dom. You know, we should pray for him this week because he's on retreat. Here you have a pastor who's young. He might not seem young to you, but to a number of us he seems very young. He's really smart, right? He's fun and funny. Here's a guy who could have done anything with his life, right? And he decided to serve. He decided to make a gift of his life to the church, to the body of Christ, to the people who remember who Jesus is and who want to put Jesus in the very center of their lives. He decided to give his life to that. What a beautiful thing, right? So we need to pray for him. We also have to pray for ourselves because the Lord is calling every one of us to do the very same thing. Not necessarily to be a priest, although maybe. Not necessarily to be a religious brother or a religious sister, although maybe. Not necessarily to be a husband or a wife, but maybe. Every one of us is called to serve Jesus in some way. Every one of us is built by Jesus for a specific purpose. And the goal of education in the faith, which we also call formation, but even education in math, in spelling, in arithmetic, in social studies, an education is supposed to help us understand, what am I good for, right? Can you all say that for me? Make that, say it out loud and say it in your hearts at the same time, okay? One, two, three. That's a very specific question. I'm good for some things that you're not very good for. You're good for things that I'm no good at. We have to find out what that is because this is why Jesus made us the way he made us. And he knows us better than we know ourselves. Nobody, not your mom, not your dad, not your best friend, not even you, know you the way Jesus knows you. Not even you know what you're good for the way he does. And he's calling you to find out how wonderful you are and how you can make of your life a gift to others. Husbands make a gift of their life to their wife. Parents make a gift of their life to their children. Families are supposed to make a gift of their life to their community, their parish, for example, the place where they work. The gift of self. That's why the Lord says, stop making my house a marketplace. You're not buying and selling, you're giving. You're giving. That's what puts us right with God. To know who you are and to be grateful and glad for who you are, I hope every one of you is listening to me, especially the upperclassmen, right? Because you're probably at the age where you start looking over the fence and thinking, well, I'd rather really be like him. Or I'd rather have some of her gifts. And the problem with that is you'll never be grateful for what somebody else got until you're first grateful for what you got. And I think your pastor is a wonderful example of this. You know, his joy comes from believing that he's known and he's loved by his Lord Jesus. And that's what enables him to give of himself so generously here at St. Edward. So it's Vocation Awareness Month. Some of us have been called to be priests, sisters, brothers, deacons. Some of us are called to be husbands and wives. Some of us are not called to that. But all of us are called to give, not to sell, but to give ourselves to others. I was 28 when I finally went to the seminary. That's a little bit later than people back then. It's a little earlier than some of the people now. But I tried, I was very interested in theater when I was in high school. And then I studied that in college, and I moved here from Ohio and worked in the Shakespeare Company as an actor for 5 or 6 years. And then all of a sudden I realized, if I am going to continue doing this, I probably could, but I'm going to have to sell myself. If I were really good, I wouldn't have to do that, but if you're not really, really good, then you can still do it, but you have to work it. You have to kind of sell yourself a little bit, and I don't want to do that. And I was a little disillusioned, right? I was a little bit sad, but I thought there must be something else. And then I had this love for the church that had always been there. And I learned later on, the church is like a building with all these different stones, and we're the stones, and everyone is different, and all together they make a beautiful building where Jesus lives. And that building, the people that make up that building are supposed to go out into the world, and like we heard in that beautiful reading, what's salty becomes fresh. The sea becomes fresh. What's dead becomes alive because of us, because of the faith of people who put Jesus, who are trying to put Jesus first in their lives. Boys and girls, may that be you today. May you come before Jesus every day of your life saying, Jesus, what am I good for today? What do you want from me today? I know you know me. I know you love me. I know that I'll never be as happy as you can make me. If I put myself in your hands, show me. Help me to hear your call. If you do that, the Lord will make you happy. And you will be a beautiful stone in the temple, which is his body, the church.
For Pope Francis, bishops, and leaders of the Church, may the Holy Spirit continue guiding them in their service to God's people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all civic leaders, may God grant them fortitude and compassion as they carry out their duties. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those without a home or who are in fear of losing their home, and for those who strive to relieve them of this burden, let us pray to the Lord.
For all those who worship here in faith, may the Lord help us recognize and live the truth that we are each a temple of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, may God lead them Help to dwell in peace in the glory of the heavenly temple. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For Bryant, for Byron Mitchell, Carmelita, and Eugenio Lacardo, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Incline your merciful ear to our prayers, we ask that you will listen in kindness to the supplications of those who call on you. We ask that you through Christ our
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, we pray, O Lord, the offering made here, and grant that by it those who seek your favor may receive in this place the power of the sacraments and the answer to their prayers. Through Christ our Lord. Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in your benevolence you are pleased to dwell in this house of prayer in order to perfect us as the temple of the Holy Spirit, supported by the perpetual help of your grace and resplendent with the glory of a life acceptable to you. Year by year you sanctify the church, the bride of Christ, foreshadowed in visible buildings, so that rejoicing as the mother of countless children, she may be given her place in your heavenly glory. And so with all the angels and saints we praise you, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and my brother Blaise our Bishop, me, your unworthy servant, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
His hand.
May God, the Lord of heaven and earth, who has gathered you today in the dedication, the celebration of the dedication of the church, make you abound in heavenly blessings. Amen. May he who has willed that his scattered children should be gathered together in his Son, grant a unity among his temple and the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. So when you are thoroughly cleansed, may God dwell within you, and grant you to possess with all the saints the inheritance of eternal happiness. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Is, but what vocation God was calling them to. And they answered that call to that vocation and how they lived that vocation out. So the fourth graders will be presenting their saints. Listen carefully, be a good audience, because someday you might be a saint and somebody might be dressed up as you telling your story.
In Poland, I will be called to be priest I live my vocation being delivered to our Virgin Mary. I'm a parent of the difference. My feast day is October 4th.
Hello, I am the patron saint of Elizabeth Ann Seton. I was born on August 28th in USA. I was called to be a religious sister. I live my vocation by helping the poor and sick. I visited hospitals and orphanages. I am the patron saint of Catholic schools, widows, and sailors. My feast day is January 4th, 1821.
Hello, I am St. Damien of Molokai. I was born on January 3rd, 1840 in Belgium. I was called to be a priest. I live my vocation by helping people with leprosy. I'm the patron saint of leprosy. My feast day is May 10th.
Hello, I am St. Catherine Drexel. I was born on November 26, 1856 in the United States. I was called to be a religious sister. I live my vocation by opening my house to the poor. I am the patron saint of racial justice. My feast day is March 3rd.
Hello, I am St. John Paul II. I was born on May 1st, 1920 in Poland. I was called to be a priest. I live my vocation by healing a nun with Paracon disease. I am the patron saint of sports. My feast day is October 22nd.
Hello, I am St. Therese of Lisieux. I was born on January 2nd, 1873 in France. I was called to be a religious sister. I live by my vocation by being the doctor of the church. I am the patron saint of missions and tours. My feast day is October 1st.
Hello, I am St. John Bosco. I was born on August 16, 1815 in Italy. I was called to be a priest. I live my vocation by teaching boys how to follow Jesus. I am the patron saint of apprentices, editors, and publishers. My feast day is January 31.
Hello, I'm Mother Teresa. I was born on August 26, 1910 in India. I was called to be a religious sister. I live my vocation by helping the poor and those in need my whole life. I am the patron saint of doubters because I show that you should hope, not doubt. My feast day is September 9th.
Hello, I am St. Thomas Aquinas. I was born on 1-20-25 or 1-20-27 in Italy. I was called to be a religious brother. I live my vocation by pursuing a lifelong of learning and sanity. I am the patron saint of Catholic universities and students. My feast day is January 28th.
Hello, I am St. Francis Xavier Cabrini. I was born on July 15th, 1850 in Italy. I was called to be a religious sister. I live my vocation by helping the poor like giving them food. I am the patron saint of immigrants. My feast day is November 13th.
Hello, I am St. Louis Martin. I was born on August 22, 1823 in France. I was called to be married. I live my vocation by praying, reading, and meditating. I am the patron saint of married couples. My feast day is October 18.
Hello, I am St. Gina Beretta Valle. I was born on October 4, 1922 in Italy. I was called to be married. I live my vocation by caring for children and doctoring them. I am the patron saint of mothers, bishops, and unborn children. My feast day is April 28th.
Hello, I am St. Pope John the 23rd. I was born on November 25th, 1881 in Italy. I was called to be a priest. I live my vocation by creating the Second Vatican Council and uniting Christianity by good deeds. I am the patron saint of Christian unity. My feast day is October 11th.
Hello, I am St. Faustina Kowalska. I was born on August 25th, 1905 in Poland. I was called to be a religious sister. I have lived my vocation by praying to God every day. I am the patron saint of divine mercy. My feast day is April 8th.
to the fourth graders. Let's give them another round of applause. Remain where they are because there might be some pictures that should be taken before they move. Everyone else have a great Tuesday, and you can head back to your classrooms.